What's going on, guys? Welcome back to more NCAA Football 14 Road to Glory. And it's week 9 in the Strong Safety Road to Glory series, and that means it is time for a stat update. It's pretty much the midpoint in the season, and we do have a bye week, so I might as well show the stats. So 83 tackles on the season so far, 28 for a loss, 3 assisted tackles, 4 sacks on the season. I've got 4 interceptions, 3 defensive touchdowns off of 3 interception returns. And then I've got 2 forced fumbles and 2 fumble recoveries, no blocks, and no safeties. I don't play special teams, so of course I'm not going to have any blocks. And safeties might be something I can do eventually in this season. Now check out the Heisman watch. The front runner this year, Donta Kirby of Navy. Then behind him, Terrell Tucker of Florida, Anthony Billings of Alabama, Corey Bratton of North Carolina State, and Jacob Whitfield of Western Kentucky. Wow, Western Kentucky's on the Heisman. Top 5 is, there's no Johnny Manziel this season. I believe he's won 2 out of the past 3 Heismans. Or maybe 3 out of 3. But our next opponent will be Donta Kirby and the Navy midshipmen. I was waiting for this matchup. Number 22 Navy, both teams 7-1 on their series. And this game should be pretty interesting. We've got the number 1 rush offense against the number 1 rush defense. Navy putting up 334 yards on the ground and only 120 through the air. So, if we stop the run, they're going to have to depend on the pass. They probably can't pass the ball. And we'll see what happens. Navy also with the number 6 defense. So, this could be a test for our team. You know from watching the past couple of seasons that the defense can handle the ground game from Navy. But our offense, I don't know. Number 6 Navy, in terms of defense, this might be a tough one. As Navy is going to come out here in their flex bone, full house, whatever you want to call it. I think it's called the flex bone. And this one will result in a penalty, and there's an offsides call on Lawrence Walker. And I go to the instant replay here, and Lawrence Walker's hand is over the football. Does that actually count as being offsides? I guess it does, because I don't know, but there they go, picking up 7 yards on that play, so a first down for Navy. And yeah, this rush game looks a little scary. As we come to line here once again, hand off up the middle, and they'll get a near first down, but I'm going to be offsides this time. And that'll set them up with a 1st and 5. I would have just taken the 9-yard gain, but they apparently wanted the extra down as they go to the pitch here. And that's going to be a 1st down. And no carries here for Donta Kirby. I'm not really sure how many touches he gets per game with this flexbone offense, which could have 4 different people carrying the ball at one time. Is they fake the fullback, toss outside to the running back, and Anthony Mack, good tackle there, and they're contained to a gain of only 3 yards. That one could have been dangerous if Anthony Mack had to make the tackle, but we're going to have to keep bringing blitzes here on this possession to try to stop this Navy run game. Hopefully someone gets in the backfield and they go outside once again, and I could have sworn I was there to intercept that pitch, but I guess that's not in this game. I haven't seen it yet, because at NCAA 13, if you ran between an option, you had a pretty good chance of actually stealing that option pitch, but I guess that time I didn't get it. As we bring pressure, they go to the pass on 3rd down, and that's going to be a sack as they have to punt the ball. Our offense puts up points, so hey, I like how this is going so far for the offense, and that play didn't work there as we get pressure on the running back and the quarterback at the same time, 2nd and 14. Bring pressure once again, another option as the quarterback keeps it, and he's tackled from behind, only a gain of 2 that time, so 3rd and 11. We got them to stop on 3rd down the last possession through the air. They're probably going to have to go air here once again. Can't really go option. Not going to get 11 yards on this team as the quarterback stands in the pocket, and he will get hit as he throws, and that will be a 4th down as the offense for Notre Dame gets the ball back once again. Now we're up 14-0, and we might be running away with this game as Navy is trying to get something going here on the ground once again. We're going to keep bringing the blitz. Not really worried about it at all. I haven't seen a carry from Donta Kirby yet so far in this game. As they go option once again, and Lawrence Walker, having none of the option, blows it up in the backfield, loss of 3. And that brings up 3rd and 12. And I really don't think Navy's a screen team, so we're not going to see it from here on 3rd and 12 as the quarterback throws this one downfield. And James Holloway, good defensive play downfield, breaks the pass up. Quarterback 0 for 2 in the game, and they'll have to punt the ball once again. Offense keeps it at 14-0 as Navy goes to the option here once again. I lost all containment on the outside as I tried to get to the quarterback before he made a move, but they pick up 8 yards. Probably could have had more if the quarterback had tossed it back to his running back. But 2nd and 2 here for Navy as the quarterback keeps this one for himself, and a good tackle on the outside by Gibson, and that's going to be a loss of 3. So 3rd and 5. Will we see a screen here? I'm waiting for them to throw a screen as the quarterback throws this one downfield, and I got completely turned around on that play, and they'll pick up 23 yards through the air. That was pretty bad man coverage. I was trying to cheat the run, and that left me entirely on an island by myself. I'm not Darrell Revis. I don't have my own island. I'm not that great in man coverage. I'm a little decent, but here they go to the run once again, and the ball's loose, and we recover. I'm not sure what happened here, but we will go to the instant replay. The first turnover on the game is Navy's fault, so we'll see what happens here, as I believe this was supposed to be a triple option, and I think the play just broke down, because sometimes when you switch a triple option to go the opposite direction, your running backs don't move where they're supposed to go, and I think that's what happened there, as now we're up 17-0. Quarterback drops back, throws short. Anthony Mack's got to play better zone or man coverage than that, as they pick up a first down through the air, and we cannot let Navy start throwing the ball. This is a run-first team. We got to keep them contained to the run as the quarterback throws off balance, and Anthony Mack's got to play better on the outside. So now Navy's got the ball past midfield, 1st and 10. They come out here 3 wide, and I'm paying attention to the run, but they've been passing the ball a lot here in the second half as the quarterback throws downfield, hit as he throws, and this one is intercepted, barely scooped off the ground, and the streak will continue. 5 interceptions in 4 games. This has just been an incredible second half to this season. I mean, going into week 6, no interceptions. I got 1 against Pitt, 1 against Boston College in week 7, 2 against Stanford in week 8. Then we have the bye week in week 9, and I have another one against Navy in week 10. And I thought the streak would be ending against Navy, because normally when we play Navy and I have an interception streak going, I never get one. That's been the way it's been pretty much going the past 3 years. And in my senior season, I'm able to keep the streak alive. So 27-0 game against the Midshipmen here in the second half of this third quarter. We're trying to put this game away. Can we repeat what we did in week 4, as I whack the quarterback in? He gets rid of the ball in time, and that's going to be Mike Wright with a loss of 2 on the reception. So 3rd and 12. Navy doesn't run screens, or at least I haven't seen him run a screen. So they're going to the air here once again. Joseph Holt with the catch. And I don't know if he's injured or something, but I haven't seen a single carrier catch from Heisman frontrunner Donta Kirby. Or maybe I'm just not paying attention as we bring the blitz here once again. And the quarterback brought down in the backfield. First sack on the game. And once again, this team just all up in the other team's backfield. Checking out this replay once again. The quarterback freaked out. Probably should have just thrown the ball away, but I'm not going to complain. I got the sack on it. So here we go, 2nd and 15. Quarterback dropping back, trying to escape, and Riley Perry having none of it. He contains the quarterback, actually brings him down for a loss of 1, so that's going to be his 3rd sack on the game with 4 tackles. So 75% of his tackles are sacks, as we'll bring the blitz here once again on 3rd and 16. Can I get to the quarterback once again? And he'll escape outside, and he does not get rid of the ball in time. He gets sacked, and that's going to bring up 4th and 23, Dane McCoy with the sack. So 4th quarters here, up 27 still, and I'll get pressure on the quarterback, and I don't know if he was trying to throw that ball away or just trying to shoo me off, but he threw the ball right at me, like literally right into my face mask. I guess he was telling me, no, get away from me, I don't want you to sack me, but it's going to happen again eventually as we'll bring pressure here. 2nd and 10, quarterback gets rid of it quickly, and they pick up 16 yards. And one thing that really annoys me is that when we're bringing blitzes, the man coverage assignments, these people aren't standing over their assignments as we bring the blitz once again, but this time the quarterback can't get away. My 2nd sack on the game. And I remember someone saying in a video not too long ago, hey, you got to get 2 sacks a game. Well, there you go, sir. I got 2 sacks in the game just for you as the quarterback tried to run once again. And this time he didn't just throw the ball at my face mask. He actually took the sack like a man as we come out here on 2nd and 16 as I almost get to the quarterback, but Brian Dixon, the, I believe, 3rd or 4th string corner, gets to the quarterback that time. So 2 straight sacks on this possession. Can we make it 3 for 3 as the quarterback gets sacked once again? Had nowhere to throw the ball, and that's going to bring up 4th and 26. And that is going to end the game. Riley Perry, 5 tackles on the game and 4 sacks. Yeah, it was that real for Riley Perry in this game. I wouldn't be surprised if he's on one of the award lists. He's actually been pretty solid this entire season. So the question here is whether or not the backup defense held the shutout. We were up 27-0 coming off the field. if our defense or the backup defense did their job, we should be walking out of here with a pretty solid win. As player of the game is Daniel Ray. I was a little surprised. I wasn't player of the game, but he had, I believe, two punt returns for touchdowns. And the final score in this one, 41 Notre Dame and nothing for Navy. This really just wasn't Navy's game. They came out in the first quarter, sticking to their game plan, running the ball. And then they really couldn't get anything going. So in the second half of the second quarter, they started just passing the ball like that was their strength. And it really isn't. And that resulted in them getting no points in this game. And I think I messed up the commentary earlier before the interception. I think I said second half and I meant second quarter. But six tackles in the game, two for a loss, two sacks, and one interception. Checking out the stat comparisons, Navy only 175 yards total in this game. They had 64 yards off of 33 carries, which is just under 2 yards a carry. So the defense was containing. I mean, come on. That's pretty beautiful against the number one rush offense. And they had 111 yards through the air. Their quarterback sacked 8 times in this game. 2 for me, 4 for Raleigh Perry. So someone else had, or maybe it was one person with 2 or another person was added. I don't know. So we had 8 sacks in this game. I think that's the season high. As our next game of the season will be against the Purdue Boilermakers back at home. We move back to number 10. Are you kidding me? This is just, it's unreal. We just blew out Navy, who was a top 25 team, and we're still moving backwards as Penn State loses to Ohio State. They move back, and then you've got North Carolina State and also Nebraska moving forward. So not entirely sure how this keeps happening, but we're continuing to move back. Our chance at a national championship, I mean, we're in week 11, so maybe we have a chance, but things are not looking good. And it's not that teams behind us are moving forward, it's that teams in front of us are losing and they're still staying in front of us. So the mission here in this game is destroy the Boilermakers. They go screen here, first and 10, and that one going nowhere, loss of 1. That screen game's not going to work when we're playing cover 3. Second and 11 here for the Boilermakers. And they'll send a receiver in motion. And this guy actually, he's moving in motion in front of the center. How is that not offsides? And they get a first down. And there's no flag being thrown. I think Anthony Mack was looking for a flag on that play. But quarterback rolling out quickly, fires short. That's going to be a gain of 9. And yeah, this is not going the way we want it so far. Third and 1 here for Purdue. Tight end moving in motion. That could be a run, but the quarterback dropping back to throw. And that one goes over the tight end's head. Possibly could have had a first down. But are they going 4th and 1? Fullback dive up the middle. And Donnie Koch and Brent Miller just couldn't get there in time. And Purdue gets the first down. 3rd and 3 here. Purdue looking to pass the ball. Tight end delay. I see the tight end moving. And I knocked the ball loose. But that's still going to be Purdue football. As the receiver has quick hands. Recovers the fumble. And that's going to make it 4th and 1 for Purdue. And they'll probably end up going for it on 4th and 1 as they barely avoid disaster on this play. I'm always letting those tight ends do what they got to do on those tight end delays. And hopefully I can, you know, at least recover a fumble. That's how I forced that fumble against Stanford in, I believe, week 8. It was a tight end delay. I came in late, hit the receiver or the tight end, and forced a fumble. As they'll go to the air on 4th and 1, pick up 9 yards. So Purdue here, looking to score. The quarterback staying in the pocket. He gets taken down, and that's going to be a loss of 8. And that's Sam Roberts, who's been kind of quiet these past couple of weeks. Hasn't really been the defensive force that he's always been. As they go to the air here on 3rd and 8, this one thrown short, and there was no way that that was going to be a first down. So I'm guessing they're settling for the field goal. They kick it, is up, and it's good. So 3-0 for Purdue. As they look to be going run here once again, I cut in behind the guard, bring down the running back, and that's going to be a gain of 2, as I really want to bring him down behind the line of scrimmage, but good effort as I don't give up on the play, get the running back, and Donnie Koch would have definitely laid the hit on that guy. So 3rd and 2, handoff up the middle once again, and we cannot get to the running back. They pick up the first down, and these fullbacks are tough. I don't know what it is, but sometimes these guys are really hard to get past. As Purdue goes to the air here on 2nd and 7, and Anthony matches confused on where he needs to be and who he's covering as they pick up 20 yards through the air. So Purdue trying to add to this lead. third and six. Quarterback will drop back. He's going to stay in the pocket. In this one, I knew where he was going with that pass, and if he had gotten that off, that would have been intercepted. Fourth and six, and Purdue misses the field goal. Now it's a 7-3 game as we make a touchdown, and that's a big hit there. They only pick up four in that one. Good tackle on the running back, as I believe that's the backup, not the starter. The starter was giving us a bit of trouble in this game, number seven. The guy was giving us a bit of trouble, second and six here, Purdue. And the quarterback throwing short, and that one almost got picked off. I think that's my first pass deflection on the season. I can't remember what my stats were earlier, but I think I only had like one or two pass deflections, maybe not any. Is that one, I was just a little behind the play and almost got the interception. So third and six, a screen for Purdue, as this one will be caught, and I was too far away to do anything about it. But I do bring the running back down the backfield, fourth and five, and I believe Purdue will punt the ball here. Or sorry, fourth and 10. And Purdue did end up punting the ball. So it's first and 10 here for Purdue. Quarterback launching this one downfield, and this one goes off of my helmet. And I don't understand why my hands didn't go up and I got the user SWAT notification. We brought corner pressure. Quarterback got rid of it. That was a bad throw. And this one just goes off of my helmet. My hands never went up. And that one should have been an interception. The game is trying to keep my streak from being continued. I'm being cheated. They only pick up two on that pass. That makes it third and eight. And they're only one of six on third down. So we'll see what they do here as the quarterback will drop back the pass. And he's going to fire this one downfield, and Brent Miller knocks it away. These corners and these safeties are playing no games with these deep passes. So 24 seconds left. Purdue with the handoff up the middle. They want to run out the rest of the clock in this first half, but I call a timeout. I say, hey, if we can force a fumble, we've got our chance at a field goal. As they'll pass here on second and eight. This one intercepted as the quarterback tried to hit his tight end, and that is not how you end the half. You should have just run the ball. You screwed up. You done messed up. As I take that one back for 6 points and give us a nice lead going into halftime and a big momentum shift. Not like momentum wasn't already on our side. And I embarrassed this tight end once again. It was the fumble earlier in the game, and now I steal the interception from him, and he's just looking silly. And this game is just beautiful. The forced fumble in the first quarter. Now this interception at the end of the second quarter, I'm in the box prepared to attack the run, but they throw here, and that was a mistake. I mean, you should have just gone into halftime with your deficit. You weren't going to gain anything by throwing the ball with 12 seconds left. As they'll try to run the ball here, and yeah, that's going to end the half there. Another tackle in the backfield. That's what they should have done to end the half, but they wanted to throw the ball. Now they're down 13-3. As our offense can't do anything with the ball with their first possession, here comes Purdue. Quarterback dropping back. It's a quarterback draw. That one's going nowhere. Loss of one. When does that ever work in our defense? 3rd and 11. Purdue going to the air here once again. I thought he would be throwing short, but he throws to the outside, and they get a first down. He probably could have gone over my head. There was a receiver on an end route that I didn't see, but 3rd and 3 here for Purdue. And I'm watching the screen as the quarterback keeps it. He's going to throw short to the outside. And that one will not be a first down. 4th and inches for the Boilermakers as they're 2 for 2 on 4th down. Can we stop him here? And that's going to be a big fat no because I ended up tackling the center. I was trying to get lined up over him so I could plug the run, but I guess I got a little too close and an animation trigger that caused me to encroach. So 1st and 10 for Purdue. Hand off up the middle. They're trying to put points on the board, and they're trying to do it slowly. You don't want to turn the ball over here because you're only down by 10 points. So 3rd and 6 after a gain of 4. And it's going to be a screen set up. Quarterback gets rid of it. I'm there for the interception, and this one's going back for 6 points. That one was a little too easy. This one going back all the way. No one even close. Second interception for a touchdown on the game. I'm responsible for both turnovers on the game for Purdue. And this season just continues to get better and better. 7 interceptions in the past 5 games, and 6 of them have gone back for touchdowns. I think I'm breaking some type of record with defensive touchdowns, or maybe eventually by the end of the season. I don't know. I'm pretty sure someone's taking back more than 6 touchdowns in a single season as they're going to be going read option here on the ground. 2nd and 8, still in the third quarter. And Purdue down by 17 points. They've got to put together a drive, and they've got to do it carefully because the pass game just has not worked for them. The run game really hasn't worked for them as they try to go outside here on 2nd and 8. And the running back only getting three out of that one as I laid the hit. And how I would have loved to force a fumble. Me and Donnie Koch in perfect unison. And he was a little late getting into the tackle. I've got more speed, so I got there first. But a third and four for Purdue. Running back offset. Is it another screen? I thought it was a screen, and that's why I played up to play the running back and totally forgot about the tight end. They get 16 yards in. Yeah, I would have loved to actually get a legit interception on the tight end once again. But second and three here. Nowhere to go on the run. And that'll bring up third and seven. And I totally forgot I had that forced fumble in the first quarter. So I've got nearly three turnovers in this game as a quarterback will drop back, throw the out route, and that's going to be a first down for Purdue. So 13 yards through the air, and that'll bring up third and nine. Shall we see another screen? Bringing pressure on this play, running back in the block, and he can't get away from, I believe that was Sam Robertson that got there first, and then I believe, yeah, Anthony Gibson on the follow-up. So this defense playing quite well, 4th and 17 for Purdue in the fourth quarter. And what are they going to do here? Down by 17. They really don't have an option but to go for it as I've got 7 tackles, 2 interceptions, and 2 for losses. We're going to play deep here. Me and Brent Miller got the first down line covered as the quarterback will stay in the pocket. And he's going to throw this one downfield. And, oh boy, that one almost intercepted by James Holloway. I was a little off there. Came at a pretty bad angle. And Purdue will get the ball back because the offense doesn't do anything. And they'll come out here first and 10. Quarterback getting sacked once again. He goes down. That's going to be Ed Abrams, who's been also quiet past couple of games with the sack. Third and 10, screen set up for Purdue, and the quarterback doesn't get rid of it in time, and that's a loose ball, and that's going to be Dane McCoy, I believe, who recovered, and he's taking this one all the way back for the touchdown. And I'm trying to tackle him because it seems like every time I have 2 interceptions in a game, someone's always keeping me from getting that third interception. And yes, I'm mad about it. The Stanford game, Sam Robertson got in the way of my third interception, and this time the screen was there, and I would have been there for the pick, but can't really do anything about it as they go to the air here on first and 10, and Purdue has a chance to put up some points here, 18 yards by Kennedy. And now first and 10, Purdue quarterback dropping back. He's going to stay in the pocket. This ball is loose again, and that's going to be another turnover for the Boilermakers, and with only 3 minutes left, we're not coming back on the field. That's going to end the game. I don't even know who got the forced fumble on that play. I wasn't really paying attention. As the play of the game will be this interception return in the third quarter that went back for the touchdown. And my stat sheet for this game was pretty awesome. I mean, the forced fumble in the first quarter, then the interception that went back for the touchdown in the second quarter, and then the interception that happened in the third quarter. Just nothing in the fourth quarter. Something would have happened in the fourth quarter if it wasn't for that forced fumble that happened. I would have had the screen, and that would have been my third pick. But can't really do anything about it. I mean, our defense played well. I think that's the big thing to take away from this game is I'm player of the game once again. 7 tackles, 2 for a loss, an assisted tackle, a forced fumble, and of course the 2 interceptions. As we're walking out of a pretty dominant win, 30-3 the final score. And it all started with a forced fumble in the first quarter. It just went downhill for Purdue after that. They had chances to put up points. I think they missed a field goal. They missed a couple of field goals in this game. And then after that, it was just done for the offense. You know, the interceptions and then the forced fumbles in the fourth quarter. I mean, turnovers add up. And they keep you from getting points as we're going to take a look at the stat sheet in a second. But there go the stats on the game once again for myself. And looking at the team stats, only 197 yards of total offense. We had 3 turnovers in the game, 3 for 11 on third down. What happened in this game? This is the second straight game where the offense just played terrible. And the offense is only responsible for 6 points in the game. They had the 2-yard run by Clark. And then we had 2 interceptions that went back. And then the forced fumble that went back. So, I mean, 21 out of 30 points belong to the defense. And, I mean, I want to complain about it. But that's pretty awesome that the defense played that well. But the offense has to be way more consistent as we finally are moving forward. Thank you. We moved from 10 back to 9 where we were, I believe, 2 weeks ago. And the upset this week is going to be the Cincinnati Bearcats, who are 7-1 in the season. They lose to University of Central Florida. And that was our BCS National Championship opponent last season. How are these guys only a 2 prestige team? Not really sure, but week 12 is over. We're just going to hop right into week 13 and see what's going on with week 13. So our opponent in week 13 is going to be the Idaho Vandals at home. And we move up again. We move up from number 9 to number 7, and Idaho's record, my goodness, 0-11 on the season. That is not good as we look to the top 25 polls, and Washington is upset by Arizona in overtime, 41-44. You also have NC State losing to Clemson, 17-34. So two teams move back, we move forward, and it looks like the luck of the Irish is finally starting to kick in this season. 0-11 Idaho is next. Hope you guys enjoyed the episode. But that's pretty much going to wrap it up. I'll see you guys in the next one. I'm out of here.